Hello, that was quite beautiful and inspiring. Yes, it was very uplifting. You can all take part today. Can we see it though? Have you switched to it? Because on my screen it's still just the intro bit. Okay. I can hear you fine on my side, so. That is weird. That is really, really weird. Have a look at this. We cannot hear the great herald of Sigma. Andy, speak up, buddy. Yes, Andy is working on fixing this right now, so let me keep you entertained here for a second. Let's say hello to everybody. Let me just scroll through all the people that said hello already hours before the show. We have YouTube Newbie, who was the first one this time. He's very proud of that. Then we have Dieter, James Mayberry, Benjamin Powell, Sefi Sogako, Talking MC1 Gamer. Good evening,
Can you
sir.
hear me now, everybody?
Can you hear Andy now? Is he audible?
Type yes in all caps repeatedly if you can hear me.
YouTube newbie already typed yes in caps. I don't know if it was already as an answer to you, though. It was a bit quick.
Because we're really taxing the system here.
We have another yes from Sefi Sugaku, so audible Andy is confirmed right
Okay,
now.
good. Because what's going on here exactly? Is that there are two versions of me in the hangout, and one of them was muted. Because obviously, I wouldn't want two streams of audio coming in at the same time. So, for those of you who missed the wonderful intro, it was some excellent whistling, if I do say so myself.
It was angelic.
So, I'll do it at the end as well,
Right.
just to make sure everyone gets to hear it.
Let's quickly finish the hello round here. I will just quickly finish it because I started it. So we have MC1 Gamer, we have Dead Gamer, we have Lady Phoenix, we have Drunken Elf once again, Grim Rick, my beholder buddy, Benjamin Paul, I think I already mentioned. And I think I might have forgotten someone, but I got most, so if I forgot you, feel yourself
Now, the
greeted.
person who got the first comment on this video was YouTube Newbie, but it's been so long since then. I think he
Yeah.
commented about 18 hours before the show started that it's disappeared, so there's no evidence of it anymore.
It's actually still there on my side.
Is it?
So I actually mentioned it when you were fixing stuff that he was the very first and he was very proud of being the first.
Right then. So, as people can see, we've got a game lined up here. A small band of dwarves in one of the realms. In the Age of Sigmar world slash universe, have stumbled across this beautiful golden statue, which is very odd looking, and they feel compelled to defend it and not let it fall into the hands of evil. So, when they see this undead legion approaching them, of course they've set up a hasty defense. Now, you can see there that we've got several dwarf units. I did take suggestions on which units were going to be included in the game from the audience. And we've got some hammerers next to ironbreakers at the front. We've got a dragon slayer in the middle there with his big butt. Behind them we've got some quarrelers and some iron drakes, and behind them we've got an organ gun and a grudge thrower. So, I'm going to be taking suggestions now on whether you've got anything you'd like to say regarding the deployment of those units as they defend against this undead tide, some of which you can't see on the camera because it hasn't entered yet. So, at the top, for the undead, you can see there are two very large zombie units, and they're on movement trays because it's going to be much more convenient to move 100 zombies that way. So, two big giant zombie units. Behind them, we have two medium-sized skeleton units, and then behind them, slightly off-camera, we have three crypt horrors on each side. And that might not be the extent of it either. However, the dwarves do have some backup in the house in the middle there. Some miners have come up through the cellar, and they are hiding in there. So whenever the audience feel like the miners should reveal themselves and join the fray, then just let it be known. And when enough people have decided that's the right thing to do, that's what we're going to go for. So when it comes to the dwarf turn, the audience are going to pretty much vote on what they want to happen. So at the start, I'll say pretty much who would you like the various units to shoot at, and then if someone types, well, I want the organ gun to shoot at the zombies, and then everyone else says, yeah, that's a great idea, then that's what will happen. So it's a very interactive experience. But before we get to that, there is something very important that I feel we need to share with the world, and it's not just this beautifully posed image that wasn't made in Photoshop at all. It is something much more important than that. We've got Rem Watch, because Rem, as you know, has been on his tour of the US of A in his musical capacity, and I'm going to show you what he's been up to. So there he is, posing in front of some graffiti.
There we go. Very urban environment there.
Yep, very bandy as well.
Very sophisticated hair, as always.
Yep, and then moving on. This is very artsy, isn't it? Black and white on steps.
Yeah, classic stair setting, very, very Brooklyn.
Yeah, very stylish footwear on some of those band members as well.
Very neatly tied shoes, I must say.
And there he is, practicing his swing. he's holding it a little bit like a sword, isn't he? A sword that's just been forged.
He looks a little bit surprised at it, like it just appeared in his hands out of nowhere.
It's like, what? This isn't how you play tennis. Moving on. There he is, in a vehicle. Oh. I don't know exactly what's going on there. It looks like it's got some kind of writing on it. I would imagine it's...
It seems to be at a car seller.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
I bet it's some kind of old car, old fancy car. It even has like the steering wheel lock still on it, so he doesn't steal it. They didn't trust Rem enough to let him in there without.
Well, they've obviously seen this show. Then, oh, there he is again. He's always lurking in the background, isn't he?
Yeah.
I'm not even convinced he's part of the band. I think he just photobombs all their pictures.
Who knows? That's a floating fish, by the way. Just a random floating fish in the background.
There is. Floating next to the word crazy.
Crazy Florida steaks, where everything's possible.
Then, there he is, with Honest Abe in the background.
You should have brought his head. A tiny, tiny hat and just like put it on top of it.
If he should have taken this picture and then compared it to a photo of him posing with the giant Stormcast Eternal outside Games Workshop HQ.
It's true.
I think we can all agree that Stormcast Eternal is far more magnificent than Abraham Lincoln.
A bit more impressive in statue, at least.
It certainly is. Now, this has been a very interesting week, because there have actually been some Age of Sigmar news developments. Well, it's been rumoured for a while because all the Lizardmen units were taken away from the Games Workshop store or out of stock or just taken away completely. But we now know why. It's because the Seraphon are coming.
Ooh.
Bum, 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 bum.
They only come to Germany, though. They're not released in any other country.
Yeah, there is that little detail. But what a coincidence. We have someone that speaks, I'm led to believe, a smattering of German. Just a touch of German.
Yes. Let's see.
So maybe you can give us the gist of what this says.
From the stars, Missy's. Beyond the Azir stars originates the Ultimate Edition of Battle Tome Seraphon, an Ultimate Edition for all.
An Ultimate Edition for all, or more accurately, for the first 500 people to click on it at midnight.
Yes, and for all who want to fight the dark gods who killed all the slain in the old world or something. Pretty much that. They want to finish the job of destroying the chaos gods. That's the job of the Seraphon. Their new job. They applied for it. Got it. Here we go.
Then, boom. Now, I don't expect you to read out all of this, but can you give us the gist of this whole thing as well?
The Seraphon are the foot soldiers of the Slan, creatures from the from sky magic, and they have mysterious overlords in the background in the endless war against the dark gods, which is interesting because some people might know that in the 40k universe, in the very early fluffs, there was a spacefaring Slan, the space Lizardmen already. So it's quite interesting that GW is kind of not connecting those timelines, but they're edging closer and closer with certain things.
So it's interesting because obviously the Lizardmen fled before the world exploded. They've just been hanging out in space all this time, and now they've decided, you know what? I don't really like the way these chaos gods are going about their business. It's time to come back and kick some serious butt. Lizard style. So, what is notable, though, as we look at this White Dwarf cover, is that I don't think any of those models are new, are they?
I don't know a lot about Lizardmen, sadly, myself, even though I play against them regularly, but the person I play against mostly uses the older models, so actually haven't seen many of the new.
And I know those troops on the left definitely are not new, because I've seen Mr. Reef's Lizardmen, and they have those exact shields, and I know that creature isn't new.
Yeah, I think that's a Carnotaurus with, like, a leader guy on top.
Yeah, so it could just be repackaging, new labeling, giving them all new names, perhaps.
Yeah, wrong
faces. A fancy
faces.
New book for them.
Pretty much that.
It'd be a little bit disappointing. Some people were expecting lizard men in power armor.
Might be disappointing, but I think it's a good sign for everyone who plays races besides Chaos and the Stormcast, because GW is now starting to apparently release books for the other races, at least the ones that have a stronger influence in the whole storyline, like the Seraphon now coming from the stars.
Yeah, and you would think that if they've been in space this whole time just chilling, they would look the same, probably.
I guess, yeah, pretty much. Depends where they hung out. Maybe they were just on another planet with gravity. Because if they were not in gravity, they would have just grown all spindly and weak-like.
And the Lizardmen were one of the more recent armies to be re-released with new models, so it would be a bit much to just scrap all those wonderful plastic miniatures for no reason.
Pretty much, yeah. They still look very good. They're not that old, so it makes sense for them to be one of the first to be repackaged.
Yeah, on the one hand, it would be nice to have some new releases to sink our teeth into, but on the other hand, it bodes well for all those of us that have armies such as my dwarves that I don't really want to be replaced by much nicer models anytime soon.
Yeah, I feel you with my orcs. And it's nice to see that GW kind of revalidates the older armies now, because before we didn't know what was going on. There were the war scrolls, of course, but word on the street was that those were just for the time, so people wouldn't have to throw away their armies right away. But this is a very good sign that there's actually books coming out now.
Indeed.
Yes.
So, very, very interesting, and I'm sure probably this weekend on the Games Workshop website we'll start to get some more info on this and see the pre-orders and whatnot, and see if they have any incredible bundle deals with about $1,000 worth of miniatures for $1,001. That's usually how it goes.
Right.
So, we're going to head back to this beautiful, not at all photoshopped logo now. And that's going to be there for the duration of this episode.
Yes, also my face might be on a small boy. Andy is not sure.
Yes, it might be.
That might confuse some people right now a lot. They might have some weird dreams tonight. Also, the guy on the left from you, he's kind of like just the finger gesture he's doing. Do you see that?
Yeah, he's actually, I think he's giving that gesture to you.
But kind of secretly he's afraid to like openly flip me off because I'm about to eat his face.
Yeah, and the guy who's reading the rule book, the question mark looks oddly positioned because of the way he's got his head. He looks like some kind of hunchback, doesn't he?
Certainly does.
So, heading over to the gaming table here. Now, I think we've had one or two suggestions on the deployment. So, I'm going to let Dready delve through the comments and have a look at that while I run over to the other side of the room. Yes. I'm going to mute myself intentionally over here and then unmute myself over on the laptop, which is on the other side of the room, where I'm going to be manning the gaming table.
Right.
It's all very new and complicated and experimental.
Very experimental. So let's see what people said in chat. Apparently MC1 Gamer just reported himself to YouTube in chat. Good job. Good job, MC1 Gamer. I could have done that for you. I have mod rights right now. what else? This is like Romper Room from the 70s saying hello to all the kids tuning in. Again, classic MC1 Gamer right here. There's the audio talk. A deep thought from Dead Gamer. Is the space in Age of Sigmar the same space that we as humans have come to know? Perhaps Age of Sigmar space has gravity. Who knows? If Age of Sigmar space had gravity, like all the planets and everything would have been like propped up on sticks or something. That would be weird. There would be like planet sticks just holding them up.
Okay, can you hear me?
Let's see. Can you hear Mr. Annie right now? Because I can clearly hear him. People are starting to drink already. But no feedback yet. Come on, people.
Can you hear me, people?
The question is if you can hear Andy right now. If yes, then type yes in caps. Sefi Sogako type no. He could be trolling. Drunken Elf types yes, but not in caps. You are all doing it wrong. I don't know if you're sincere if you're not doing it in caps. There. Grimrig did it in caps.
Okay, good. This is all very experimental, as you can tell. So, ladies and gentlemen, where shall we begin? Have we had any suggestions on changes to the deployment setup?
I haven't seen any suggestions so far. They were all just hanging out, just waiting for stuff to start.
So, I'm going to whip out some dice right now. We're going to have the turn dice atop this mountainous region here. And these mountains are, for aesthetic purposes, it's not at all to stop me having to reach all the way over the table. That wasn't in my thinking of server. So let's get some dice in out of the wonderful Dice Bag Lady dice bag.
Yes. Everyone should have one. I actually bought two in my time, so... Sefi Sugako screams Dragon Slayer at the front with 4 exclamation points.
Okay, there he is.
5 even. There we go. Iron Drake's on hill to right, Benjamin Powell.
Well, unfortunately, all these hills are so foresty that they're impassable.
Let's see, YouTube newbie. The troops are blocking line of sight to the artillery.
Okay. So he's suggesting that we should spread out the troops a little bit so everything can see through each other. That's not a bad idea. So let's start spreading them out, shall we?
The Iceberg Lady is cool. She's on Twitter somewhere. Mr. White Mask. Welcome, Mr. White Mask, to the show. Also, I agree, the Dice Bag Lady is quite cool and everyone should check out her little shop at thedicebaglady.net. See what she has to offer. Dead Gamer, push the statue over and roll it over the zombies. Steamroller style.
Okay, there we go. Now, we can safely assume that the missile units can see through them, and we can assume that the war machines can... Let's just make a little bit of space here as well.
Right. We are not cheesing it with artillery on hills right now.
Nope. Anyone else have any suggestions before we get this bad boy underway?
Let's see. Reverse U, Iron Breakers protect the shooty drakes. That actually sounds like a solid recommendation here. So have a U with the open side pointing towards the camera and then put the iron drakes inside that iron breaker U, I guess.
So he wants like iron breakers like that as well. Is that what he's saying?
Right? I think that looks right, yeah. They're kind of encompassing the iron rakes now. Yes, that looks good.
Okay.
Good enough.
So, here's what we're going to do. We are going to see who's going to get the first turn.
Yes, that's important.
Yes, now I know the turn sequence very, very well because I've got this wonderful combat gauge from Litco.
That's quite a quality product right there, isn't it?
Almost as quality as this custom one that says Andy 2D6 Delicious on it. Almost as quality. But that doesn't have the turn sequence on there.
Also, YouTube newbie is right. A reverse U would be an N. So, there we go.
So, let's see who's going to go first then. So, on a 1 to 3, we're going to have the Undead going first.
It's a...
Okay, it's the Undead with a 3.
With a 3, so alright.
The Undead are going to be moving up because they don't really have much else. They've just got a lot of troops right now. So, the move value of the zombies and skeletons are 4 inches and the crypt horrors are 6. And I think... Let's just move them up 4 for now. This is going to be very, very quick because I've got them on these handy-dandy movement trays until they get into combat.
See, people, you get your movement trays. Stop whining.
Stop whining! The Crypt Horrors are just going to stay behind there for safety purposes.
It looks like Age of Sigmar versus 8th edition, Dead Gamer says. It does a bit, doesn't it? It's funny.
It does. I'm sure once the combat starts, they will be straight off these movement trays. Now, I think they should probably run as well. Because they do want to get a little bit closer, don't they?
Yeah, that would be wise.
So, let's run at the zombies here first. Oh,
wow.
Look at that.
Good job, zombies. Good job.
That is a mammoth movement there for the zombies. And the skeletons behind them. 2 inches.
They're not really fast today. They might still be a little bit tired. They just rose from the grave. They're still a little bit stiff.
These ones aren't tired at all.
No. Maybe they slept in a swamp. They're like quite moist and movable now.
Skeletons behind them? That's just 1 inch again. And the cryptoras are going to get stuck behind them. Okay. So I think you can just about see all the undead units on the battlefield at the moment. So, the Undead don't have any ranged abilities. So, it's going to be the Dwarf turn now. So, folks, important things. Who do we want to shoot at? And with what? We've got Iron Drakes, we've got Quarrelers, we've got an Organ Gun, and we've got a Grudge Thrower. What should our target priority be right now?
Yes.
And remember, we also have Miners lurking in there that we're going to want to reveal at some point. You can see them just hiding, chilling inside the building. Any point that the audience feels like it's a good idea, we're going to bring them into play out of the house. So, target priority. Give us some idea what you want, audience. Yes. Also, the engineer is with the organ gun right now. If anyone would like him to move, let me know. Or if you want anyone to just advance and get killed, let me know as well. If you think that'd be a really good idea.
Type in the chat, YouTube newbie minus in caps, drunken elf minus. As I just type minus. No context.
Oh, well. So what they want to shoot at the miners. Okay. So the organ gun has... did they not mean that?
No, I don't think so. Sefi Sogaku, all the artillery at the big undead unit on the right.
Right, the one that was feeling quite speedy and rolled 6.
Yes.
So if anyone wants to oppose that view, then they should make it known pretty quick, otherwise we're going to go straight into that.
Yeah, I'm waiting for opposing words from anyone. MC1 Gamer, focus fire on the closest horde, he says, which is kind of the same.
Also, it should be pointed out that the Iron Drakes aren't currently in range of anything, although the Trollhammer Torpedo is, so that's probably going to have to shoot at them. And the Quarrelers, they have a range of, if I can find their war scroll right here, where did I put it? Oh, it's in this big pile right here. I've got all the war scrolls scattered all around the table at the moment. Professional. There we go. They've got 20-inch range on their crossbows, which isn't bad. Which means that they will be out of range. I think one or two of them might be in range of the big zombie unit, actually. If I just get the old tape measure out to check that.
Right, so we don't have a command phase right now?
Well, we don't really have anything useful to do in the hero phase because the engineer can heal a wound on a war machine,
right,
which hasn't taken any damage yet. And we only, apart from him, we just have the Dragon Slayer, don't we?
Yes. Someone said run the Dragon Slayer straight up to the closest horde. I think Benjamin Paul said it. He also said engineer to grudge thrower to the zombies on the right.
So he thinks the engineer is going to do a better job at the grudge thrower. Well, let's have a look at the war scroll and just refer people to exactly what they do. So if you have an engineer on the organ gun, then you can re-roll the dice to see if the organ gun jams, which basically means you can fire with more barrels safely. Whereas the grudge thrower, if you have an engineer on that, then you can... Where's it gone? The grudge thrower can fire 2 grudge rocks. Yeah, that's it. That's what I thought. So it can fire twice if he's with the grudge thrower. So if anyone else has any suggestions on the engineer, drop those in
based on
that information. And then I think we should fire the Trollhammer Torpedo, because there's only one possible target for that, and that's the zombies over there.
Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. Also, MC1 Gamer opposes the running of the Slayer into the Horde straight away. He says, save it one more turn, thin out the Horde first a bit.
Okay, so we're going to fire the Trollhammer Torpedo at that unit there. There's a lot of zombies in it. So the Trollhammer Torpedo hits on a 3, wounds on a 3, and then does D3 damage. So let's see if we can take out any zombies with that. Hits. And fails to damage.
Aww.
And I believe 2 crossbowmen, 2 quarrelers were in range of that zombie unit as well. So we might as well shoot those while people are deciding where the engineer wants to live. So they hit on a 4 and wound on a 4. One hit. Nothing.
So
not quite enough range on the standard shooty guys just yet. I'm thinking next turn they're going to have a good time. So, any more suggestions on where the engineer wants to go?
The engineer. Someone said it should go full hero and charge straight into the undead horde, but I don't think that was a serious suggestion.
Well, we can go with that if people want to do that.
I say the engineer charges forward himself. Yeah, there we go. There's that. Let's see, anything else? The engineer is actually mind controlled by the undead, and he shoots all the guns at his fellow dwarfs. All right.
Well, I think the only suggestion we had was for him to go to the grudge thrower, wasn't it?
Lord Cunningham actually said that he was serious with charging the engineer into the undead, but I think at least two other people were opposing that view.
Yeah, I think that's enough to counteract his wishes. So let's run the engineer over towards the grudge thrower.
Yes.
So he's got plenty of movement, so he's made it all over there. Now we're going to fire these grudge rocks into the zombies.
So one gamer is already panicking because he thought we would do that and charge the engineer.
Okay, so we've got two grudge rocks to fire. There are still three crew left, so it's going to be hitting on a 3+, and then it wounds on a 3+, and it does 3 damage. So here we go. Both hit.
Very nice.
So, 3 dead Zumbis, but I'm just going to see if there is some kind of bonus on this. So, one thing I forgot to do at the start. After it's set up, you may select any enemy unit on the battlefield. The crew has scored settle against that unit. You can re-roll failed hit and wound rolls against that unit. So I think that was the nearest unit anyway, so I think we would have chosen that. So let's roll that wound roll, shall we? Okay, so 6 dead. See, there is space for unit fillers in Age of Sigmar. There are some gravestones on there.
Yes.
So, we've got the organ gun left, so how many barrels of the organ gun should we try and fire? If we fire, let's see, if we want to fire a lot, let me just check here. If they load 2 or more barrels, roll the dice. If the result is equal to or greater than the number of loaded barrels, then you can make the attacks. So, you have to roll equal to or greater than the number of barrels, and we can fire up to 4.
Right, how many do we want to shoot right in the
1, 2, 3, or 4. So if you roll 1, you can't possibly fail. If you roll 4, then you've got a 50-50 chance of failure.
Yes. Also, people are pro popping the miners out at some point to give the dwarves more shooty time at the undead. Once it's the turn for that. We have 4 barrels, we have 4 barrels, we have no barrels, we have 4 barrels, we have 4 barrels.
Okay, so people are saying 4. That's the general consensus. So
and we have just go cray-cray.
On a 4+, it can actually fire. This is the risk that was taken by not leaving the engineer there.
Yeah.
4+, it gets to fire. Oh!
Oh!
It jams.
Good job, audience. Good job.
They were totally relying on that engineer. This is why democracy doesn't work.
Yeah. Oh, God.
So, now, the miners, someone did say earlier that they should be kept in for the moment and then pop out next turn, I think.
Yes. I think that was the original idea of it. I don't know if that changed. The comments moved quite quick, and I just saw some sort of popping them and giving the orcs, I wanted to say, the dwarves more shooty time. But I think that will also work next turn. So.
Yes, but we are moving into the charge phase, though, so if anyone's desperate for the miners to charge out of the building right now.
Make yourself heard right now if you want the miners to pop out of the little house.
If anyone really wants them to charge into this full undead legion, or they'd rather wait till next turn.
The suicide miners.
This big statue, by the way, it's very, very shiny. So whenever the undead get to within 1 inch of it, they're going to be at -1 to hit everything.
Okay, we have a no on minor charge. We have an okay wait till next turn from MC1 Gamer, a no for the minor charge from Benjamin Powell, wait then from Drunken Elf, and I think that's quite clear right now. Yeah, and more waiting with the minors until next turn. So you have made your decision, people. Hope you don't regret it.
Okay, so that's everything. So we've got the battle shock phase. So D6 plus 6 for the zombies, and they have a bravery of 10. So if we get a high roll here, some of them could disappear. Nope.
No.
So no more dead zombies from battle shock. So let's just remove those corpses, or those double corpses, since they were already corpses.
I won't read your rear comments, YouTube newbie, but I have seen it and chuckled internally.
Okay, so we need to see who goes first in turn two now. Because, as you know, in Age of Sigmar, it's not just I go, you go, I go, you go. It's I go, you go, and then sometimes you go, I go, I go, you go, you go, you go, I go, and so on.
MC1 Gamer asks if you shot the Grudge Thrower twice.
Yes. We fired two rocks.
Yes.
Due to the engineer being present.
Yes, you just want to make sure, I think.
So, we thinned out a few zombies in turn one. Let's see who's going first this time round. So, 1 to 3, it's the undead again. It's a 4, so the dwarves get to go first this time.
Right. It also was suggested if the zombies have a standard, they would get D6 zombies back. Do they have a standard?
They do.
They do. So they actually get stuff back then, right?
In there, I believe that will be in their hero phase.
Oh, so that's the thing.
So, what do we want to do with the dwarves this time? Do we just want to do the same again? Just pummel them with shots, or does anyone fancy some movement?
Yes, any fancy moves? Yes. Any fancy tactics?
Yeah, because I don't think there's much we can do in the hero phase. Because the Dragon Slayer, I don't think he has anything particularly that's going to be useful right now. Just checking on his war scroll to make sure I've not forgotten anything.
Right. I'm looking at the comments if any movement thingies come up. Pepperzim from MC1 Gamer. Happy Sagaku, Dragon Slayer, straightforward, the zombie horde. Move up in shooting range, Drunken Elf. Dwarves don't move, YouTube newbie. So they all say something completely different. But I think it would be fair to charge the Slayer and then just shoot the other stuff, maybe.
Well, let's move the Slayer forward 4 inches then.
Right.
And nice
there was also the suggestion to move the other shooty guys into shooting range right now. That was one, but there were also voices against that. I'm trying to figure out how many right now. Chat is a bit crazy at the moment. So let's see.
Well, let's see if moving would actually help them get into shooty range. Because I don't think it really would.
So, yeah.
I mean, we could get a few more quarrelers into range if we just shuffle them forward an inch.
Yeah, that sounds good, I guess. Sounds good.
Okay, so we can get...
We have, from Benjamin Paul, move the hammerers towards the other hordes.
I'm not sure the world's going to agree with that one.
I'm waiting, let's see. They're talking about the pants that the Slayer doesn't have at all. They're still talking about the Slayer, his lack of pants.
Yeah, he does have a big butt. So, I don't think they want us to really move anything else.
No, I think their moving is boring to them, and they just want to shoot.
Okay.
And they only want to see the Slayer die heroically.
Okay, the Trollhammer Torpedo, let's shoot that again at the zombie horde. Hits. Doesn't damage again.
Yeah.
These zombies are just resistant to Trollhammer Torpedoes for some reason.
Yeah, they are.
So we've got 8 quarrelers that can fire this time, because we moved them up into range a little bit. So, they were fours and fours. So, we might kill some here. We've got three hits. And only one. Only one damage, and of course zombies don't have a save. So, dead zombie. Shall we fire our grudge thrower now at the zombies again?
Yes, I think that's...
We can reroll that. That's two hits. And another six dead zombies.
Which is a good thing in this case. A very, very good thing.
Okay, and we've got... How many organ gun barrels do people want to fire? Let's get that figured out.
Yes, organ gun...
Do people really want to risk firing four barrels again?
Just type a number of how many barrels you want, just the number. See if there's anything else. No, just talk about so other things.
Number of organ gun barrels, and does anyone have any fascination with charging the miners out of the house yet?
We have three from Drunken Elf, three Benjamin Powell, MC1 Gamer, three exclamation points.
Okay, that seems to be the general consensus. Let's go with three barrels at the zombies. Okay, it can fire. Oh, so, okay. We're firing three barrels. So, for each one, we have D6 attacks. So we've got eight shots. Not bad. Not bad. Then there are... So let me just check on the old to hit abilities. So it's going to be hitting on a 3+, because it's got right. Three crew left, and then it's going to be wounding on a 3+. So, quite a few hits. We could kill quite a few here. Right, we've killed another five zombies.
Very nice. Also, yeah. I heard voices about holding the miners back still. Maybe the plan is to charge the undead in the rear-ish, but that doesn't really apply to Age of Sigmar with bonuses and such. Please clarify your minor suggestions in the chat again. Type them out clearly so I know what's going on right now, because it's a bit crazy with the chat.
I think overall people want them to stay in the building for now, though, don't they? Until the undead have moved up a bit, so they're not going to be overwhelmed.
I think so, yeah.
So let's go on to the battle shock test for the zombies, and they might have to take some more casualties this time, because how many have they got dead there? Looks like 11. So, 11 plus 2 is 13, so they've got bravery 10, so 3 more. They're going to go, So, let's remove all those corpsified zombies.
Flank double charge already. How can I flank charge them? I'm not even in the game.
They could come over to telling the unit to flank charge someone. It's telling you to flank charge someone. Is there someone outside your window, possibly, facing sideways that you can flank charge?
I really hope that there is no one outside my window right now.
So, it's the undead turn. So, time to just move them up.
Yes, also regenerate their ranks in the...
Yes, the other units can bring back, I believe it's D6.
I think it's a D6, right.
Let me just check. Yeah, D6 slain models. Four come back to life.
I'm not the general. I'm just the assistant right now. I'm just kind of the middle person between Chad and Andy right now. I make zero decisions. I just tease you. When you make decisions and they fail horribly.
Moving up all the units. And so, I wonder if those zombies should try to charge somebody.
So, do we have a charge confirm on the zombies, people?
Because they could make it into the Ironbreakers, or they could make it into the Slayer.
So, charge on Slayer or on Ironbreakers, you decide. Give us your opinion in chat right now. Also, okay. Always try to type as clear and to the point as possible, so I can mostly instantly see what you want. Okay, charge and charge zombies is not very specific right now. We need a target. Charge the Nazi zombies doesn't help either. There's more screams for the charge, death to the dwarves, charge, charge, charge. Slay the Slayer, that's the first actual specific target declared.
He is the closest, and he does have green hair and a big butt, so I think he would be the obvious target, wouldn't he?
Yes. Also, I know you don't have to declare charges, but you know what I mean. Don't be a nitpicker, MC1 gamer. Gee. Nah, it's cool. It's cool.
Well, let's just charge at the Slayer.
Actually, MC1 gamers, right? You roll and decide what you can charge after that.
Yeah, but I think they want to charge the Slayer anyway.
Yeah, I think so. The Slayer. So
but prime Slayer. They haven't rolled high enough. So, no charge for the zombies.
No charge. How's that? How's that?
Right. So, it's time to see who's going to go first in turn three. 1 to 3, it's the undead. It's the dwarves. Okay, folks. Things are going to be seriously in range now. So, do we want any movement? Anyone suggest movement?
I'm waiting for stuff to come in.
And if you don't want to move, then tell us what you want to shoot at. Also, whether you think the miners should pop out yet. So they are still lurking in there.
We have moved the Ironbreakers up to the zombies and sent the Slayer in to target the skellies to the right with the Grudge Thrower and the Organ Gun in the zombies on the left. MC1 Gamer, charge those breakers, charge the Slayer zombies.
So it seems pretty clear that people think the Ironbreakers and the Slayer should be making a beeline for those zombies.
I think that's quite the point right now. Shoot Ironbreakers in right zombies, Quarrelers into left zombies. The dwarf units in the front pull them back behind the gun line. Alright, so it's completely the opposite.
So I think a few people said move forward with the Ironbreakers, didn't they?
Yes. Ironbreakers,
let's go for that.
Closest units. Seems to be what most people can agree on.
So
also MC1 gamer, the left of the screen, pretty much. What you see is that left. Not Andy's left or like something confusing like that.
So the Ironbreakers going out dancing. The Slayer. And any other movement? Do we want the miners out yet? And any Miner other suggestions catch. On what to shoot at?
Let's see. No focus fire on one unit at a time. Standard procedure. From YouTube newbie. People cry for to send the giant in, but he's a statue, guys. He's a statue.
He is, although he did just creak a little bit. And as people look it up into the sky, they may notice that there's a bit of a storm brewing up there.
How ominous right now. Ominous.
Yes, very, very ominous.
Okay, there's no more really suggestions. Speak up on your minor suggestions right now, people.
Okay, so they don't think we should shoot at the zombies over here because they think they're about to get eaten in combat. points.
MC1 Gamers has focus on those zombies, but everyone else doesn't want complete focus fire, it seems, right now.
So everyone else wants to shoot at other things, like on this side. Well, the Iron Drakes will have to shoot at those zombies because nothing else is in range, so let's just do those.
Right.
So, they have... Just make sure they're in range. Yeah.
Okay, we have...
Don't forget to run all the undead units, by the way.
Oh yeah, you did.
Oh yeah, because I charged that one unit and they failed, so they couldn't run. So, in fact, while everyone's making their mind, I'll just run all the other units now. Shh, don't tell anybody.
Okay, we have miners should pop out and hold up the crypt horrors, MC1 Gamer. Drunken Elf, save the Slayer, no use in killing him yet, move up your units into shooting range.
Okay, so, the Iron Drakes, we've got 9 regular Drakes, and we've got the Trollhammer Torpedo. So, they also have their special ability, so that they can fire twice with their Drake guns, so we get another 9 shots.
Right.
Because they didn't move. The Trollhammer Torpedo can only fire once, though. So, they all hit on 3s, and they damage on 3s, but the Torpedo just does more damage. So here we go, into those zombies. That's a lot of hits.
That is indeed a lot of hits.
We can kill lots of zombies here. The torpedo failed to wound again. So that's 10. 10 dead zombies.
Not bad, not bad. I know MC1 Gamer is quite keen on wiping out that unit of zombies completely and then finishing them in close combat. That's what he wants really badly right now.
Now, I brought back some zombies in that unit, didn't I?
Yes. We have a sent the miners into the Crypt Horrors from YouTube Newbie.
The miners into the Crypt Horrors. Which Crypt Horrors? 2
oh,
units.
Yeah, that's 2 units.
Specified. Here or here? Which side? The right or the left Crypt Horrors? Who do you want to charge at? So, while that's going on, let's fire the Quarrelers, shall we? I assume they're going to fire into these zombies here. So, I think I've got 15 of them.
Alright.
15 Quarrelers.
Okay, we have one voice against charging the miners out of the building yet. I'm waiting for a second one to cancel out the charge right now.
Okay, so there's going to be one of these. Is this black dice is the champion of the Quarrelers unit who gets +1 to hit. So most of them hit on 4s, he hits on a 3, then they wound on 4s. So, he missed, and, only 3.
Okay. People say if you charge the miners out, then to the right, into the right unit.
Okay, so we'll do that in a minute. So before we get to that, we've got the artillery to shoot, bridge thrower, and the organ gun.
Also, people, just so you know, it won't be 100% fair who gets a say in what happens, just because I have to keep an eye on the complete chat right now, and sometimes it's moving really quick. Plus, the popped-out chat is being a bit special at points and just jumping around, so keep that in mind. Don't get mad.
If you're going to get mad, then make sure you get mad at Dready.
Yeah, and if you get mad, make sure to write it into the permanent comments after the show.
Yes. And also, if you're really, really mad, then go and subscribe to Dready's channel and complain on all their videos.
Yes, go to Gloom Dready Gaming. And download all my videos. Every single one.
Who are we going to shoot at then with this artillery?
The artillery. Earlier I read something about Grudge Thrower to the right hand skellies we have from Benjamin Paul.
Okay, let's go with that. If people want to go with that, we've got two ready to fire. They won't have their rerolls this time because they only have a grudge against the zombies then and dead. So it's threes and then threes. One hit. So that's three dead skellies.
Right.
Okay, that's the Grudge Thrower and the Organ Gun. How many barrels should we fire? Presumably at these zombies. They're looking quite a threat right now.
They're looking like quite a threat, that's true. Okay, people, we need numbers again for barrels. 1 to 4, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, and while people are deciding that, because we're not firing it over there, I'll just move the miners out of the house.
Oh.
And we're over there to charge now. Right, so they're going to charge into the cryptorus here.
We have 3 barrels. We have 4 barrels. We have 3 barrels. So far it's 3 against 4. There's 3 times 3. So far 3 barrels. It's a very clear decision on 3 barrels right now.
Right then. So, here we go, 3 barrels, so we need to roll 3 or higher, and it's a 1.
Wop wop.
So, no organ gun this turn. So, what else have we got? We've got charges as well now. So, we've got the Slayer and the Iron Breakers into the zombies. So, let's go with the Slayer first. He's in. And the Iron Breakers... 9 inches, that should be far enough.
For yeah, that looks like they get in there.
Yeah, so most of them have made it right into the fray.
Dun, 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 dun.
And now, because we've got some combats going on, we've got another very interesting aspect of Age of Sigmar to decide. We have to pick which unit we want to activate first in the combat.
You heard it, people.
We've got the Miners on the Cryptoras, we've got the Slayer, and we've got the Iron Breakers. We have to decide who's going to fight first. Because if whoever doesn't go, there's
just
a risk they could be attacked.
Just type the unit name.
Yep.
Just the name. Nothing else.
This is where Age of Sigmar can get quite tactical. Deciding who's going to attack and who's going to risk.
MC1 Gamer says, I see Lord C, but don't think Gloom will okay it. Oh, I see. That's an aberration for one of the other chatters. I see. Okay. I thought it was some tactics.
He's just so used to him giving out tactics that he's reading everything as tactics that he says.
Yes, everything he says is tactics. Okay, we have Miners. Miners first. Miners on Cryptoros. I said one word, guys. Gee. But I guess declaring the target is all right. So you could like type the name and then a little arrow towards what they should attack. So far it's all Miners. And then Slayer first, or it might go down. But Miners is winning right now. We have another Slayer.
Miners it is. Let's get them all crunched in there. So, yes. Crunch, crunch, crunch.
Slayer would be the second then, I guess, in the vote right now.
Okay, so the Miners. Let me just grab their war scroll from here. So, they have... As their weapons, they have the Miner's Pickaxe, which has a 1-inch range, which means that, how many have we got fighting here? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm going to say, 10 of them fighting, they've got a Prospector who has 2 attacks, so that's going to be 11 attacks. And they hit on a 4, and they wound on a 3. So let's get 11 dice. Hit on a 4, wound on a 3. That's looking pretty good. Wounding on a 3. Right, we've got 5 wounds in on them. And...
any steam drills is the question?
No.
No steam drills.
The Cryptoras have a save of 5+. The pickaxes have a rend of -1. So the Cryptora saves are at 6+ now. So they've lost 4 wounds, which equates to 1 Cryptora.
Which is okay. Just better than nothing. Also, people remember, we are not trying to try hard the game right now. This is all just for fun and giggles and to have a bit of a community experience. So don't be too serious about what's going on right now. It's crowdsource tactics, pretty much.
So,
and what happens
to do now is I'm just going to delve into my token set here.
Do you have Pokey, the Grudge Pony? And one gamer wants to know.
We do not have a Grudge Pony.
Aww.
I think I actually sent mine to you because I didn't think it would ever be useful.
Oh, yeah, it's now on the minus on my Kings of War, Abyssal Dwarf, Berserker base because they're actually GW minus my Berserkers.
Right now we're going to use these wonderful tokens from Litco. So, unit activated token going onto the miners, so we won't forget. See how wonderful these wonderful tokens are.
Quite helpful, especially for forgetful people like me. I have tokens where I can write on.
So,
and then I can get to use them.
The zombie unit is going to have to attack next, I think.
Right.
So, this could be... I'm going to have to count how many of them are left, actually, because that could be important, because it gives them different abilities. So, we've got 21 remaining zombies.
Right.
So, if... let me just see... so they get better the more they have. Let me just see if that actually affects their... here we go. Add 1 to hit rolls if they have add 2 if they have 20 or more models. So add 2 to their hit rolls. So they hit on a 6 normally and wound on a 6. They're going to be hitting on 4 and wounding on a 6 now. Oh, it's hit and wound rolls. Yeah, that's right. So they'll be hitting and wounding on 4s. So we've got 21 zombies.
21 zombies.
Guys moving off the tray.
Empty one gamer.
Anyone wondering why I'm leaving all the corpses there? It's for battle shop purposes.
Yes, indeed. MC1 Gamer says that he would forget to eat, sleep, and go to the bathroom if he didn't have tokens to remind him.
That is actually a very good point. I have a token, which I put on my forehead every morning when I wake up. After I brush my teeth, I stick it on my head. And then whenever I look in a mirror throughout the day, I remember, oh yeah, I already brushed my teeth today. So, we're going to attack, I think, 3 zombies are going to attack the Slayer. Because they would do, realistically, because he's not struck and they might have a chance to possibly damage him. So, here we go. 4s and 4s. So, he takes a wound. And because the Slayer, he's got no save. And we're going to go for the wonderful Litco wound counters, which I'm going to spin round. He has 5 wounds normally. He's down to 4. So I'm going to turn it to 4 and leave that on Mr. Slay. Mr. Big Butts. Mr. Alric Big Butts, and he cannot lie. Then the rest of the attacks are going on to the Iron Breakers.
That's
quite a lot of misses there. Quite a lot of misses. Not as many as a housewife convention. Right, so there's 8 hits and 4s to damage them. Wow, that's a lot of 1s. Okay, that's true form for zombies. So only 1 point of damage gets through. And they don't have any mend because they're zombies. And Ironbreakers have a save of 4+.
That's pretty good.
And they do have an ability that helps their save, but that's only if they didn't move. If they didn't run or charge in this turn. And they did charge in, so they don't get to reroll the save. So 4+ save for Ironbreaker.
Right.
He's dead.
What?
The zombies kill an Ironbreaker.
One single Ironbreaker is dead right now. Tragedy.
Yep, so the zombies have now activated. There we go. And it doesn't really matter who we attack with next, because there's only 2 combats going on, so let's just attack with the Slayer, shall we? So, the Dragon Slayer. He's got 2 axes, so he has 6 attacks, 3s and then 3s. Here we go. So we only hit half of them. 1 damage, so 1 dead zombie from him. And the Ironbreakers, let's get them all piled in nicely. We've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14 left. One of them is an Iron Beard. I think it is Iron Beard. He can make 3 attacks instead of 2. So they have 2 attacks each, he has 3. So there were 14, so that's going to be 28, so 29 attacks.
We have a Slayer rerolls once from Benjamin Powell right here. Is that true? Did you forget that?
Yes, I think I did forget that.
Holy crap.
Let me just check. Yeah, you can add 1 to any wound roll for the Dragon Slayer if the target has 1 or more wound, so no, you wouldn't get that.
Ah.
And you can reroll hit rolls of 1 if they're armed with axes. Did I roll any 1s to hit?
I was too busy looking at the chat, to be
honest.
I think I may have
got 2, so. More hits. 1 more dead.
Ah, there we go. That's nice.
Okay, so. How many of these did I say? So there were 14, so 29 attacks in total. So this is going to be fun, counting all these dice.
Also, just a little thing, try not to troll too much with contradicting false rules right now, because I actually have to keep up with the chat, and if people try to troll me and say stuff is not true, which is true, even though they know it's true, then that's not nice.
It's not nice at all.
If it goes on for too long and should get too disturbing, like, I will ask to stop, which I do now, and if it doesn't stop, I might have to do other things.
Yeah, you know what happens when the Germans get angry.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Ironbreakers, when they are hitting you in the face, they are 3+ to hit, 4+ to wound. That's a lot of hits. Right, the wound rolls.
I should really get the second screen for stuff like this. I could just have gotten my tablet and have the thingies open on it.
That's going to be a lot of dead zombies.
Oh yeah.
3, 6, 9, 11.
Oh man, that horde is pretty much decimated right now.
Is
there anything left in it?
There's a few left. So, they're going to need a little battle shock test in there, I feel. So, the Crypt Horrors now. Yeah. Let me see what the range of their attacks is, actually. It it's only an inch. So, we'll be able to attack because that guy was closer. So he died.
I have a YouTube channel. Actually, it's Gloom Dready Gaming. It will be in the video description down below if you are interested in the link. So you can download all my videos.
I'm sure they will.
Which will help me as much as upvoting them, so that would be great. You could do that.
Okay, here we go. Three attacks each for the Crypt Horrors on the Miners. You're not supposed to attack Miners. You're not allowed to give Malkar either.
Right.
So, here we go. They hit on fours and they wound on threes, but if they get six to wound, then it does three damage instead of two. So, fours to hit. Average. And threes to wound. There's a six there, so that one's going to do three damage. That one's going to do two. So that's five damage. I'm going to check what the minus save is. It's five plus, and the Cryptoras do not have rend. So five saves of five plus for the minus. And three dead. Three dead miners.
Yeah,
oh no, I forgot to put an activated token on them.
Oh no!
And him. And them. Now, interesting thing here, because the skeletons are within range, fighting range, of the miners now. So, I've seen some debate over whether they should be able to then join in with the combat or not. What should we go with?
What are we going with? I was half reading right now, so I only got the last half of your sentence.
So the skeletons are within fighting distance of the miners.
Right.
Even though they weren't charged or anything.
But they are in fighting distance. That means they would pile in to the closest enemy model and make the attacks.
See, that's what I think, but I've seen some people disagree. So let's get them in, shall we? Get off that tree. In fact, I'll just turn them around on the tree. There we go.
Oh, Skeleton Flower is here. Hi, Skeleton Flower. I have actually watched a few of your videos. At some point, might even be sub to your little channel.
Little channel, not big like this one.
Not a massive channel like this one, no. Where only all the famous people get to be on camera, while the others have to like only show their hands and be the hand slaves on the table.
Yeah, that's a fact. So we've got skeletons with spears that have a massive 2-inch range. Mm-hmm. So that means plenty of them are going to be in the fight here, and I'm going to be using my handy-dandy lit co accessory to see who's in range.
You don't hear massive and 2 inches too often outside of wargaming talk, actually.
You don't, oddly enough. So those six there, 7, 8, 9 of them are in range to attack for now. So 9 attacks with the skeletons.
Happy Sugarco says you have a massive channel.
Yes, that's true. And also, they can make one extra attack with their melee weapon if they have 20 or more models, which they certainly do have that many. So we're going to double that to 18 attacks.
Alright.
This is the thing with Undead. If you take them in large quantities, you're quite happy to move them around. That's why movement trays can still be useful in this. So, that's pretty much all we need to consider. With the spears, they're 5 plus to hit, 4 plus to wound. Quite a few hits, actually.
That's good. Your channel gives Happy Sogaku channel envy.
I should hope so. 4 plus to wound the miners. 3 wounds, so they get their save there. and only one of them failed.
Oh.
So another dead miner.
You get respect for your hard work on your channel.
I do.
Yes.
I'm very respected in the community. So that's all the combat units activated. So it's time for some serious battle shock now. So the Crypt Horrors, they only took one casualty, so it's not even worth rolling.
Right.
The zombies here only took one casualty, only took three, so it's not worth rolling. And so those skeletons took... Wait a minute. Yeah, they were shot at, weren't they? They took three, so it's not worth rolling. These zombies, I have a feeling they're all going to disappear.
They're short. They're really short.
Five plus... 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24.
Wow.
So 14 more will die. So the entire zombie unit disappears.
Yes, they got evaporated right here. So the community tactics worked in this regard, in destroying this big zombie unit right here.
They certainly did.
A lot more praise for you right now. A little praise for me, just a bit. But I really don't work as hard on my stuff as Andy. Not even remotely. So, he deserves it.
Off they go. Didn't even need to take them all off the train in, because they're all dead. Okay. Let's get those skeletons. And the dwarves need a battle shock as well, the miners. So, the miners' bravery is... Bravery 6, and they've taken 4 casualties.
Uh-oh.
So that's up to 10, so that's 4 more run away. That's not good.
Right.
Miners looking a bit thin on the ground now in that fight.
They're dwindling, but they were at least a distraction, I think.
They were.
At least that.
So, I think we're on to the undead turn now, aren't we?
Undead turn, undead regenerating.
Yes, so I don't know whether there's anyone eligible for that. Actually, there's this zombie unit, but they don't have a standard bearer. So I don't think anyone can regenerate, because that Cryptora died, so he can't heal any wounds.
Right.
So it's just the movement phase. So let's move everybody up. Now, should we be attempting charges here? Let's see how far away they are. 8 inches.
Could work.
Yeah, I think they're going to have to charge the hammerers. And the... Those guys are all stuck in that combat.
Right.
And, oh, what's this that's just happened?
What?
Something strange is going on.
Oh, this is so strange right now.
Oh, no, look at this. 5 black knights have just appeared.
Da, 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 da. There they are.
On the can you see them?
They just rode in onto the screen. They were out at the beginning, but now they're on.
There they are. So, they're not going to charge in this turn, because that would be mean. They've just come riding in to see what's going on.
Yeah.
And now, this unit of zombies is going to charge at the hammerers.
Oh, that will be interesting right now.
It will. Let's see if they can make it.
No, of course they can't. Which is very good for the dwarves. Very good.
It is. And nobody else can move because they're all stuck in the fight. So, this time the undead are going to be deciding who fights first because it's their turn.
Yes, indeed.
So, what I think is that the Crypt Horrors are going to fight first.
Yeah, sounds good. Just eat those little miners. Eat them right up.
So, 6 attacks from the Cryptoris. They need their 4s and then 3s. They need 2 hits. So that's 4 damage in total because they do 2 for each one.
Alright.
So 4, 5 plus saves on the miners. And only one of them fails. They're doing well on their armor saves, these miners, aren't they?
They certainly are.
So I think the miners are going to have to attack back. So, audience, how many attacks should we be putting on the crypt horrors, because we do have a choice, because they could be piling in kind of that way or that way, these two in the middle. So should we be focusing more on the crypt horrors or more on the skeletons? Let me know.
Just type crypt horrors or skeletons to make your vote on this.
And if you type it in all caps, then your vote carries extra weight.
It will. Also, indirectly, people say that they would maybe love a dice cam at some point. But that's extra technical setup, which is set up. So.
It is. This is a very experimental episode. If people like this and they'd like to see more episodes like this where we do audience participation games, then we'll look into getting multi-camera setups and things like that. It's very, very possible.
Yes. So it could happen, people. You see, they all say horrors. Horrors, 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 horrors. Don't base it on skeletons. Cause of other icon. You could just have typed horrors. That would have worked too, but that's
okay.
All right.
So I think he's been fighting Range of the Horrors as well. He can't because he can't move away from the skeletons, so there's five of them can attack the horrors. So the prospector adds an extra dice. So that's going to be six attacks on the crypt horrors. So we're on fours and then threes. Oh, that's not very good. One damage, the crypt horror with his 6 plus save fails. So he takes a wound, which I'm going to mark on him with this wonderful handy-dandy Litco wound marker. They have 4 wounds each, so he's down to 3. And then it's just skeletons left again, so they're going to keep piling in, like so. Getting as many in there as possible. Because that's what skeletons do.
White Mask says, it's pretty fun, but more Stormcast Corn Seraphon. Alright.
Well, no comment. Okay, so let's see how many skeletons are within the 2-inch range to fight this time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And there's still more than 20, so that's going to be 22 attacks. So there's 10.
So Sefi Sogako tries to psychologically influence other people in chat to vote for what his vote would be.
So skeletons, fives, and fours. So quite a few hits.
Benjamin Powell wants to know how the storms are doing in the sky right now, Andy.
The storms are brewing up nicely.
Oh.
Very, very interesting developments up there in the clouds for anyone who's paying serious attention. There's a kind of a metallic hue around the edges of the clouds, which may be noted if you look up there, stare directly into the sun.
It's certainly quite metallic. I can see it clearly, actually.
It is. So, we've got 6 damage, 6 wounds done to the miners, so they will need to make their saves. 5 plus. Oh dear.
Oh.
That's 6 dead. That's everybody dead. All the miners. They've thrown away their lives holding up this undead legion.
Yeah, they did their jobs.
They did. So, by the way, I forgot to do a battle shock test for the Iron Breakers.
You could say it was a minor sacrifice.
But it didn't matter that I didn't do a battle shock test for the Iron Breakers because they have bravery of 7 and they took 1 casualty. So the maximum I could have rolled is 7.
Right.
So they're fine. And that's the lot. So we're on to turn 4 now.
Turn 4.
Dun, dun, okay. So on a 1 to 3, it's the undead going first.
Let's see. And it's
a 3. It's the undead. Uh-oh. This could be bad. Everything creeping up.
Creeping along.
Da, 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 da. The cryptors are heading over that way a bit now. So, let's move the skeletons as well, shall we? They're giving up. And the Black Knight, whose war scroll I just forgot to get out.
Oh, there it is. Get to the telephone.
So they have a move of 12 inches, which is quite significant.
People are apparently amused at the bad pun I did. I'm glad it worked.
Okay, so it's time for some charges for the undead forces. The zombies, into the hammers.
Oh, will they be able to make it? That could be very, very...
Nope, they don't make it.
Wow, good job, zombies, good job. A bit more time for the dwarves.
Skeletons at the iron breakers. Okay, they definitely make that.
Yes. Dun, 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 dun.
I think Cryptor is going to try and charge them as well.
That doesn't look like it, no.
The Black Knights are just going to run.
Well, halfway quick.
They want to get into the fight faster, because they were late to the party. And these Cryptors, I think they should probably try and charge the Ironbreakers as well, shouldn't they, looking at that?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Right, and they go.
Yeah.
11 inches.
Clearly in. Yeah, those dwarves have a problem right now, I would say.
They do. This is what happens when the community decide that the dwarves should run out into the open when there's legions of undead coming.
Oh, yeah, the dwarves are a bit under pressure right now, but it still looks good. Look at that line of dwarves down there. There's so many dwarves.
Yeah, it's still looking okay. So, we've got lots of units involved in the combat here. So, the undead are going to attack with their cryptors first, who have three attacks each. So, fours and then threes, they're all going to attack the Ironbreakers.
All right.
And most of those missed. That's three successful damage has got through, which does six damage in total because they do two each. So four plus saves for the Ironbreakers. And they pass all of them.
Did you save for every single point of damage? Don't you just save for every wound that comes, not for every hit that comes through, actually?
I believe... Because
I don't think you save every single damage point. I think you save against the actual successful hits. Wounds, I mean. Like the two wound rolls.
That may be the case.
That's at least how I play it. And it is.
We need MC1 Gamers to clarify that one for us, but I saved them all anyway, so that's fine.
Yeah, that's all. That's not a problem.
Okay, who do we want to attack with first? We've got the Ironbreakers, who can attack the Skeletons or the Cryptors, and we've got the Slayer, who can attack the Skeletons or the Cryptors.
Yes.
What should we do, community?
Let's see, Sefi Sugaku said what Dready said on the dice rolling issue, but I'm waiting for things to come in.
I think you are correct, actually. So I may have been doing that wrong so far this game. But it hasn't come up that much.
No, not really. Not really. There were not as many guys who did multiple wounds so far, so that's all right. People are just asking what's happening. Maybe they didn't pay attention. Kill dwarves, okay.
Well, I'm thinking that they probably want the Slayer to hit first, if no one says anything.
I would say.
Before he dies, and they want to attack the Cryptors because Let me just see if they have any keyword that would make him especially good against them. Let me see. I don't think they're classed as a monster.
They might just... No, I don't think so.
No,
I think
they're
too small to be monsters.
Yeah, I think he'll still want to attack those, probably. Or will he want to try and knock down the skeleton numbers? Or will the Ironbreakers want to try and knock the skeletons below 20 before they attack, so they get less attacks?
Yes.
What do you think, people?
Tell us now what should happen in this combat right now.
Try and reduce the skeletons, make them less deadly when they strike, or try and kill some Kryptonus. And who should be attacking first, Slayer or the Ironbreakers? Come on, people.
If the Slayer has Kryptors, then focus him on the Horrors from Sephi Sugaku.
By the way,
Slayer gets extra attacks on Horrors. No, I think we just checked that. They are not monsters. Reduces skeletons. And focus as many breakers on the Horrors as possible. Skellies, all on the Horrors, knocks the skeletons down. Ironbreaker skellies, Ironbreakers first.
Okay, I think we should go with that then.
Yes.
So we've got...
Horrors are multi-wound, he says, so does it say anything about multi-wounded models on the Slayer War Scroll for Boney? Because I think...
He has one wound rolls if he targets creatures that have more than one wound, yes.
Ah, so there's a bonus.
But he doesn't do double damage against them because they're not monsters.
Right.
So let's get the Ironbreakers onto the skeletons. And by the way, as this is going on, there is a slight parting in the metallic-hued cloud up in the sky. It should be pointed out.
It's quite parting right now.
It is. So we've got these attacks onto the skeletons with the Ironbreakers. And the Ironbreakers will be hitting on threes, wounding on fours. So that's that many hits. And five wounds on the skeletons.
Bop, bop, bop. Okay.
We still haven't knocked them down below 20. So now that the skeletons attack, they're going to be getting a lot of attacks in here.
Oh my.
Yes, this could be painful.
Yeah, people were not on one page about what to do. Some said that the cryptors take permanent damage while the skeletons regenerate, while others pointed out that the skeletons do more damage when they are over 20. Which is true. So quite the dilemma.
With better rolling, we could have knocked them below 20, but sadly, nope.
Sadly not.
So let's see how many are going to attack the Ironbreakers. We've got 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 17 times 2. So we've got 34 attacks on the Ironbreakers.
That's a lot. Ironbreakers might not have a nice day right now. MC1 Gamer, what did you miss? There was stuff dying. The miners died. Also okay. A lot of paid charges on the zombie side. High Gym plays games.
Here we go. A big pile of skeleton spear attacks on the Ironbreakers. And there's still more to come on the Slayer, isn't it? So, here we go. Hit on fives, wound on fours.
A lot of dice.
Finding all the
hits. Jim plays games, asks if he missed the golden butt attack. So far you didn't, Jim. So
no, you can hang around and you won't be anywhere near that, so you should be quite safe. But it is going to happen very shortly, the golden butt attack. Wounding on fours.
Right.
All that and only three rules.
Holy crap, that's just the typical. I see rolls like this.
Wounded.
Wow, good job, skeletons. Good job.
Okay, now five of them. So 10 attacks on the Slayer. I need one hit. And it wounds, so he's down to 3 wounds. Okay, now the Slayer's going to attack. Do people want to attack the Cryptoras? Because they haven't struck yet. No, the Cryptoras did fight, didn't they? Or did they?
Yeah, because I think you rolled those saves. And then
yes.
I asked, do you roll them? Yeah.
So, it doesn't really matter who the Slayer attacks for that for those purposes. So it just depends who we want to whittle down further. Skeletons or Cryptoras?
Skeletons or Cryptoras. If you want to have a say, type in now, skeletons or Cryptoras.
I suppose he has the bonus against the Cryptoras, so we should probably do that, shouldn't we?
It would be wiser.
If no one says anything, then we'll go with that, because he'll get plus one to wound against the Cryptoras. So he would be at threes, and then twos to wound then.
Alright, so far, we have one for horrors. Two horrors, three horrors.
Okay, here we go then. Threes to hit first with rerolling ones.
Actually, Sugaku cheated. He typed horrors twice and once in caps.
Rerolling ones.
Still works.
So, three hits and then twos to wound. So, three wounds onto the Crypt Horror.
Alright.
So, three. And now he's down to one. Because he only had four. Actually, he does have saves, doesn't he? But he's got rend of minus one, so six plus on the save.
Right.
So no, he didn't save any of them. And battle shock. The Iron Breakers only took one casualty, so they don't need it. Skeletons, if they're all six, then they'll take an additional casualty. No. Because they've got high battle shock. High bravery value because they're undead, so they don't know about fear, and they didn't take very many casualties in the first place. So, it's now the dwarf turn. So, folks, what do we want to do?
Decisions.
We want to decide if we're going to be doing any movement, but while that's going on, something from the heavens has just opened up. A golden light has just cast itself down onto the battlefield in this kind of region. It's got a kind of holy aura. And
those special effects are quite impressive right now. It's not even CGI, even though I myself can't believe it.
That's right, folks. The Stormcast Eternals are here. Five liberators from the celestial realm have come down to help the dwarves defend this golden wonder for the glory of Sigmar. And also, while that's going on, the dwarves have noticed that this large golden statue has started moving. Boom, boom. Boom, boom. That's how giant golden statues move, by the way.
Right.
So we'd beat the drum next to them whenever they take a step. So, we now have a huge golden giant on our side as well.
Which is a good thing. MC1 Gamers did a comment there, made me knock over my water bottle. but I won't read it on the show loudly, even though it's funny.
Okay, so we now have a giant. Movement. Where do we want to move, folks?
Yes, tell us the movement. Tell us the unit towards which other unit or however. It's not the shooting phase now. It's moving phase.
Moving? These people need to get themselves a Litco turn sequence combat gauge.
The Andy and Ren show, sponsored by Litco.
Move
the giant forwards. Okay, that's the only Hammerer's Charge from MC1 Gamer and move Giant forwards are the only two things we have right now. Hammerer's move from MC1 Gamer, Giant move from MC1 Gamer.
Okay, so the Giant can move 8 inches.
Okay. We have Benjamin Powell, have the Iron Breakers through a Cinder Blast Bomb. Oh, throw a Cinder Blast Bomb in the next shooting phase at the Crypt Horrors / charge the Hammerers and all guns to the left.
Oh, sadly we don't have any Cinder Blast Bombs. Okay, I'm going to move the Hammerers up because they want to charge the zombies, don't they? According to the audience. So we'll get them very, very close. They can't possibly fail the charge.
Right.
Even because there's obviously a big patch of mud or quicksand or something around here because the zombies have failed so many charges. So they're not taking any chances. And then Mr. Giant is going to very carefully...
tiptoe.
Yeah, I think we're going to have to edge the quarrelers this way a bit to make space for him to get past.
Yes.
So he doesn't kill them all. Still space for the organ gun to see through them. So, Mr. Giant. Boom, 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 boom. There he is. I don't think people suggested any other movement, did they? Where do we want the Liberators to go, folks?
Yes. Liberators, what to do, where to go.
Tell us where to move the Liberators, and then also, who should we be directing our shooting at? Because remember, you can shoot at units that are locked in combat.
Benjamin Powell wants the Iron Breakers to throw that Cinder Blast Bomb at the Crypt Horrors.
There is no Cinder Blast Bomb!
Well, there's no bomb. Too bad. No bomb for you. Let's see, Stormcasts, rear charge skellies, don't block line of sight to the zombies, Liberators versus Black Knights, into the Black Knights. And then there's a lot of cries for firing all the guns at zombies ever.
Yeah, a few people said knights then. So we're going to move the Liberators that way a bit to make the charge easier.
And that sounds fitting.
That's yeah, you don't want to get charged by Black Knights, do you?
Yes.
Okay. So, we're moving on to the shooting phase then. So, everyone wants to shoot at the zombies, do they?
There were a lot of cries for zombies. If you have any different opinions, then type in now what to charge, what to shoot at with what, because now it's all about the shooting.
Yeah, we've got a few options here. We've got... big block of zombies, some skeletons there, Crypt Horrors, more Crypt Horrors at the back there, and Black Knights.
Right.
And to shoot, we've got our full complement of shooting still here. We've got the Iron Drakes, the Quarrelers, the Organ Gun, and the Grudge Thrower still.
We have Iron Drakes versus Skellies, Grudge versus Horrors. Drakes versus Horrors, Grudge versus Skellies. So pretty much the same. Oh, MC1 Gamer just typed it again, just in caps. It was just him. Yeah, I guess it's that. Drakes versus Horrors, Grudge versus Skellies. And we have one Quarrelers versus Zombies, also from MC1 Gamer. Pretty much like it's mostly Sefi Sugaku and MC1 Gamer playing the game right now. Everyone else just went into just viewing mode, into potato couch mode. Couch potato mode, there we go.
Okay then, so let's fire the Iron Drakes at the Cryptons. That seems to be a unanimous decision. So, we're going to have our threes to hit, threes to wound, and the Trollhammer Torpedo is the black dice.
Oh no, I see it. MC1 Gamer. He actually changed up his stuff to shoot at, but what I said in the end was right. So, the correct one.
So that's a lot of damage.
No, MC1 Gamer, keep typing and doing the tactics. It's more fun if more people do it.
The Cryptorers are going to have to make their saves. They won't get one against the Trollhammer Torpedo, so let's just see how much damage that one does right now. Oh, it's crooked. Does one damage, so that finishes off that Cryptorer. And then the rest of these, they're going to have to make their saves, which are going to be at minus one ren for the Drake guns, so they're at 6 plus now. Wow.
There's also a gun. There
we go. There's just a couple of steaming, fiery craters where there used to be three Cryptorers.
If they were wearing boots, then there would but just be like two pairs of smoking boots on the ground right now.
I think they were wearing boots, actually. Made from the innards of black orcs.
Yes. At least those.
Yeah. So, should we fire the Grudge Thrower at the skeletons now?
Yes.
Now, the engineer's still there, so we can fire twice. So it's 3 plus to hit, 3 plus to the wound. One hit. And it wounds, so that's 3 dead skeletons.
Alright.
And we've got the crossbows. So who are we going to shoot at with them? The zombies?
Crossbows at what? Are there the Quarrelers, the guy with crossbows?
Yes.
We had one vote for versus zombies.
Okay, let's go for it then.
Yes.
So they hit on 5, put their war scroll somewhere, there it is. 4s and then 4s, yeah, that's right.
Also, the funny thing is, in the beginning, people were saying stuff like, oh, I can already see who will win, there's so many undead, the dwarves will be super dead, but it doesn't look too much like it right now, doesn't it?
No, even before the help was coming.
Yeah.
The thing is, the undead, they have a lot of troops, but the reason they have a lot is because they're awful.
Yeah, it's true.
So, the zombies take some casualties. We've got the organ gun left. What did people want to shoot at with that?
Organ gun at what?
And how many barrels should we be unleashing?
Yes, types of target and the barrels. Target unit / number of barrels.
And then after that, while that's going on, we want to decide who is going to charge at what. Because I think the giants could try and charge somebody. So tell us who you want the giant to charge at while you're telling us how many organ gun barrels we should be firing and at whom.
We have organ gun versus zombies, everyone pretty much, and we have a 4-barrel vote right now and a 3-barrel vote. And another 3-barrel vote, so I think the 3 barrels have won right now.
Okay, here we are, going for 3 barrels. Okay, it fires.
Yeah.
So let's see how many shots it's going to put into the zombies. 7.
Alright.
7 shots into the zombies. 3s and then 3s again.
Mm-hmm.
So 4 more dead zombies. So that's that entire row gone.
Very nice.
Which had its own little tray. So they're dead. And has anyone told us where the giant's going to charge?
Yes, giants into the skellies. Most people said that.
Did they say which skellies?
They actually didn't. I think the closest skellies, right? Which would be the ones behind the zombies?
That would be them. That would be an 11-inch charge. If he doesn't quite make it, he can always choose to go for the zombies, though.
Yes, that's true.
So let's roll that for the giant. 6 inches, so that won't be enough, but it will be enough to reach the zombies, so we can just happily go in there instead.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, boom, 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 boom. Okay, and the hammerers are charging in as well. They don't even need to bother rolling because they're so close. And the liberators, I suppose they should roll to see if the bad guy can get far enough. Yes. So.
Yeah, that worked nicely.
Okay, in they go. So, we've got a lot of combats here. So, who do we want to attack with first? We've got Hammerers, Giant, Ironbreakers, Slayer, and Liberators.
Type into chat right now which unit should attack first.
This is a truly interactive wargaming experience.
It actually is. I would be quite excited if I would be on the viewing side right now. I actually have like a bit of a problem following both the comments and the game right now, but I roughly know what's happening. Giant, Ironbreakers. Yes, more coming. Giant. We have 3 votes for Giant.
What
against 1 for Ironbreakers. Oh, Benjamin Powell typed it twice, so we have 2 against 1.
There are only 19 skeletons left, so they've been dropped below the threshold of getting an extra attack. So there's no rush to kill them for that reason. So it looks like we're going for the Giant then, doesn't it?
Yes, Giant stuffs a zombie in sack, MC1 gamer.
Okay, so the Giant is going to try and shove a zombie in his pants. So, pick an enemy model within 1 inch and roll a dice. If the result is at least double the enemy's wounds characteristic, he shoves them in his pants. So let's see if a zombie can be shoved into his metallic pants, or... No, I think we need a classier way of saying it. He shoves them into the celestial realm of his pants.
Indeed.
Okay, here we go. He rolls a 1.
Whop.
So the zombie, it was so slippery, it just kind of dripped out of his pants when he put it in there.
My Giant never makes that roll easy. I always roll a 1, so I'm used to seeing that.
So no zombie in his pants, but he does have plenty of other attacks.
No zombie in his pants.
Okay, so he's going to use his... Let's go for the massive club first. So he has 3d6 attacks with that. Here we go. 12 attacks.
That's a lot. Very neat.
12, and the massive club hits on a 3, wounds on a 3.
Also, a lot of people have figured out that they can actually make 2 votes and I will count them both because I kind of skip the names at some point if they mix up how they write it. If they write once in caps and once not, I will count both.
Very devious, these people, aren't they?
They are.
So that's 7 zombies from the Giant Club, first of all.
They got clapped right here.
They certainly did. They went clubbing. We've got his Ed Butt, which is a single attack, and hits on 4, wounds on 3. So it hits, it wounds, and it does d6 damage.
I always wonder how giants do that. Like, go they down on their knees just to crush someone with their head?
Yeah, I'd like to see this guy headbutt a zombie. Look at the height of him.
Yeah, he would have to, I don't know, roll over.
I just realized this zombie unit has a skeleton in disguise as a zombie.
Oh. There could be a zombie half underground, so maybe just like half skeletized.
Okay, that was his Ed Butt. Now he's got his kick. Mighty Kick,
4 plus,
which is 1 attack, 3 plus, 3 plus.
Ooh.
It's... doesn't damage. So he kicks a zombie, but his foot just goes right through it. There must have been a hole there. So that was quite tremendous damage.
Yeah, the club mostly does the most damage on a giant. The rest is very, very luck-based.
Yeah, also it's lucky he didn't roll a double when charging with the giant, because otherwise he would have fallen over. Okay, so the undead are going to be striking now. And I think that they probably want to fight with the Black Knights first.
Yeah, that sounds good. Reducing those storm cards.
Pesky Liberators. So let's refer to the Black Knight War Scroll, shall we?
Yes.
So now they only have 1 attack each, although the horses have 2 attacks each, which is interesting.
They don't get a charge bonus or something?
They didn't charge.
Oh, yeah, it's true.
So, there are 4 of them. plus a Hell Knight who has two attacks. So that's not very many attacks, really. They do get plus one to their wound rolls and damage when they charge. So, here we go. Hitting on fours, wounding on fours. No damage.
Wow.
The skeletal horses, they have two attacks each, so that's going to be 10. It's because they have their skeletal steeds, hooves and teeth. So one attack for the hooves, one attack for the teeth. So they hit on fours and wound on fives.
Alright.
Wounding on fives. Oh, three wounds from the skeletal steed, and the liberators have a 4 plus save.
Against horsebites.
So they lost two wounds, that could have killed one.
Wow, two guys got bitten by horses right
now. Bitten to death by a horse.
Yeah, they wanted to feed some carrots, celestial carrots, but it just made the horses mad.
And kids, if anyone out there ever asks if you want to try their celestial carrots, then call the police immediately.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Okay, so we've activated the giant. The Black Knights have activated, so who wants to go next? We've got the Hammerers, the Iron Breakers, and the Slayer, and the Liberators.
Yes, type it now.
I'm assuming it's going to be somebody in this combat, but do we want to go with the Slayer or the Iron Breakers first?
Slayers or Iron Breakers, people. That's your option right now. It's your choice. Your choice alone. They're talking about carrots right now.
Celestial carrots, I hope.
How mighty horses are. Iron Breakers, we have one vote for Iron Breakers. We have another vote for Iron Breakers. Another one on Iron Breakers. Yeah? Dragon Slayer will survive to make full attacks. So one for Dragon Slayer and a lot for Iron Breakers right now. One more for Slayer with a billion exclamation points. And then he tried to cheat by typing it again, but I called
it. Well, just for that, it's going to be the Iron Breakers going.
Yes,
there.
Yes, and he's still spamming it, which okay. Doesn't work.
So, it's going to be 4 plus and 4 plus. No, 3 plus and 4 plus, I should say. So that's quite a lot. I'm not sure whether I rolled enough packs for the Iron Breakers last turn. Ooh, that's bad. Seven dead skeletons. Okay, so I think it's time for the skeletons to strike back. Now, four of them are going to try and kill the Slayer. So, five plus, then four plus. Two hits, one wound. He's down to two.
Slayer's the life people, so you didn't have to fret too much.
We've got nine skeletons on the Iron Breakers. Fives and fours. So two wounds on them, so they get their four plus save.
Which they
fail.
Wow.
Now, they do get to re-roll it because they didn't move this turn.
Oh, yeah.
And one of them dies. And so what have we got left? We've got the Hammerers, Zombies, and the Slayer, I think.
Did the Stormcast already attack?
No, they haven't attacked either, actually. So there's the Skeletons done. So, who's going to go next? I think it's probably going to be the Hammerers, isn't it? Because the Zombies haven't fought yet.
I think people were like crying for the Slayer to do something.
He could, but the unit he's fighting have already activated, so it'd be a bit pointless, wouldn't it?
It would. I guess it would. So people, make your decision known right now. If you're quick enough, it will happen live on your screen at home.
I'm counting out enough dice for the hammerers to attack if anyone wants to do that. I'm assuming they will.
I guess. There's no one talking right now. Is my chat broken? Did it just break? I don't think so. Someone write something.
Have they all passed out from the excitement?
It could be. Like, maybe their attention span is, like, dwindling. We have one hammerer. I want from Benjamin Pauli says hammerers.
Well, let's get them fighting then.
Yes.
So, I think this game isn't going to last much longer looking at it.
Yes, so, I don't think so.
3+ and 3+ for the hammerers. It's going to be a lot. Dead Zombs. Four, eight, 12 dead zombies.
12 dead zombies sitting on a tree. Dun, 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 dun.
That's a big pile of dead zombies.
Right.
So what's left? So the zombies can attack now. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 15 of them. So they only get plus 1, so they're at 5s and 5s to do any damage now.
Yes.
A lot of 5s actually. 1 damage. Hammerers have a 4 plus save, which he fails. How embarrassing.
Huh? At least that one wound got through.
So that's the zombies done, and then we've got the liberators.
Dun, 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 dun. I think the undead are getting quite hammered right now, like in general.
They are. 2 attacks each. 4 plus, then 3 plus. Let me just check if the liberator special dude has more attacks. Yep, he makes an additional attack.
Alright. Yes, have you Sugaku?
2 damage from the Black Knights. And they fail their saves.
I actually expected more from the Black Knights, to be honest.
Yeah, they're not that great in this.
Yeah, no. I'm a bit disappointed about them right now.
This player attacks now.
YouTube movie, even before the statue and the liberators arrived, the game was going quite well for the dwarves, I think.
I think it was.
Not sure Germans aren't funny.
Oh!
He's happy that I would, but I disagree.
Many, many hits. Only 2 dead then.
Well, wait.
2 more dead skeletons. That might be enough to wipe them out. Let's see. So, we've got a lot of battle shocks to do. These zombies. I think they might just disappear. Plus 6.
Ooh.
Yes, they're gone.
Yes, very much. Yeah, I'm pretty sure the pro community tactics for the dwarves have given them the edge, Sethi Sugaku.
They certainly have. Look how careful I am with these zombies. Look at this really neat pile that they've formed. So, that unit is sliding away forever, never to return. Battle shot for the skeletons over there, they could disappear as well.
Oh.
It's a 4. 4 plus 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So that's 16, so 6 more will disappear.
Well, not quite enough to make them vanish completely, but...
only four
very
left.
Close. I'm very close right now.
Time to be extra careful with the skeletons as well. Okay, I don't think you need to train anymore. Come on, you're being silly now. Battle shock for the Hammer and the Iron Breakers don't need it because they're bravery 7 and they only lost a single model each, so there's no way they could fail. The Liberators, however, are bravery 6, so if I roll a 6, another one of them will toddle away. Nope, so just the one. And the Black Knights only lost 2, so they can't possibly fail. And I think that's the lot. So, have both of the armies had turn 4? They have, haven't they?
Yeah.
So, do we think that the undead should just surrender at that?
Well, at this point, that unit of zombies there, I don't see a great chance for them. Or are there skeletons? I think they're skeletons. On the left, can't we tell?
Yeah, they're going to die. There's only 3 Black Knights left, 2 Crypt Horrors, and these skeletons are about to get eaten for dinner. Look at this.
Yeah, and the artillery is still intact. There's still a lot of a gun line happening there, and I don't see a big chance for the undead to turn things around right now.
Not at all.
No, so...
So, with that, I'm going to abandon the gaming table and make my way over to the PC again.
Yes.
So,
yes.
I'll
Do you
be
have
right
a name?
There.
Yeah, go over. Go over there. I will entertain... People are talking about games they had, what they played against. The undead can't win now. Yeah, pretty much. It's funny. In the beginning, you see 100 zombies and cryptos, and you think that's just too much. Like, the dwarves have no chance.
Okay, here I am. I have returned.
You have returned. I was just talking about like how it looked so much in the beginning, like the dwarves were super outnumbered. But it turned around quite well, even without the help of from the Golden Statue and the Liberators, I think. It would have worked out.
It did. Those dwarf units are just nasty, aren't they? I mean, when I was putting together the army, I thought maybe 15 or 15 hammerers and 15 iron breakers, maybe that's not enough. Maybe I should give them 20. But
yeah.
They don't go down easy with their decent saves against really terrible infantry like zombies and skeletons. Even in mass numbers, they're still going to be missing a lot of attacks. And they don't really have any rend.
Yeah, the rend is a big factor indeed. I think the best you can boost is zombies to hit on a 3 and wound on a 3. I think it can't go better than 3.
Also, keep in mind, though, that undead would normally have some characters who would be able to buff up their troops as well.
Indeed. It would have looked different if they would have a Wit King with them. Or I think a vampire was also good at boosting stuff with zombies.
Yes, something that Sefisagaku just pointed out. If you do focus damage on one unit, then Battle Shock really kicks their butt.
Indeed. Battle Shock is a big factor. Never forget to do it.
Especially against undead with bravery 10. You really need to do a lot of damage before Battle Shock is going to affect them.
Yes, indeed. You need to focus fire a lot to make those hordes dwindle. It's important. Very important.
So, if people liked this, then let us know and... Actually, after the show is probably the best time to leave feedback on the technical side of it, like what would you like to see whether you'd like to see games like this again and what you would like to see that's different, what changes could be made to the format next time. But it's better to leave those in the permanent comments so we can go back and look at them later on.
Indeed. Because the attention span has run quite short right now, also on my side.
Now, someone did a comment asking if we'd heard about the Total War Warhammer pre-order, and what it's probably referring to is the fact that the Chaos Warrior race are, I don't know if they're going to be exclusive to pre-order, but you do get them if you pre-order. I imagine there'll probably be a DLC afterwards, but you do get them if you pre-order.
Right.
So I'm not usually a fan of content that you only get if you pre-order, because then you can't really wait for the reviews to come out.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Now, of course, they want to make it a little bit more interesting to pre-order, so they put something. I can totally understand their decision for that, but I really hope it's a DLC you can actually buy afterwards and not a pre-order special. That would be sad. And it's not a good decision, I think, at all.
It would be bad if people were forced to miss out on Chaos, but I would imagine people will be able to download it and buy it later.
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
It's just like, here, if you pre-order, you get this piece of DLC for free that you would have to pay for if you wait.
Pretty much. It's just a little bonus. So it should be okay. They are a good enough company, I think, to consider those things.
Time will tell.
Time.
It's looking very exciting all round, though, that game.
Yes, it does. I'm looking forward to it a lot.
The more they reveal, the more everyone starts salivating, I think. Every time I talk and it brings up that amazing non-Photoshop picture that we had to get an entire room full of people around a Warhammer table for. It just reminds me what a great day that was. When you transformed into a little boy for a few hours.
With my favorite red whatever I'm wearing there.
Also, did you hear about the imminent arrival of the Horus Heresy game?
I have actually heard it today. I haven't seen any box art or anything yet because I didn't look after it specifically. But apparently it's on the horizon and being announced, so that is exciting for all the people who are actually interested in it.
Yeah, apparently there are posters and whatnot around game shops that are going up
with
Horus Heresy written on. So seems like it's going to be November for that.
Yeah. It was way too much of a really expensive niche within the niche of 40K already. And now that more people will be able to play it, it will help everyone, I think. No matter if some people use their plastic models from some starter box, maybe, or the other people use their super costly Forge World resin models. There will be more people to play with, and that will be great.
Yeah, it'd be interesting if the rules are very Age of Sigmar-like and not 40K-like. I think the internet is going to completely flip.
Do you think they will release an extra rule set for 30K? Because Forge World already has, like, a big library of actual 30K rules, so I'm not sure they would go that step. But with Age of Sigmar, who knows what could happen? Like, that was a big surprise in itself.
Someone says it's going to be a board game.
Wow, that would be boarding.
That would be an interesting choice. I don't think the community really want that.
No, I don't really think we need another GW board game right now. Especially not if it's limited, and then not limited again, and then limited again.
It's limited until they miraculously find another 10,000 in a warehouse.
Yes.
So I think what it means is the person who's updating the status on the website, whether it's limited or not, whenever he closes his eyes and he can't see any, that means they don't have any in stock. So he sets it to unavailable. And then whenever he opens his eyes again, oh look, there's pallets full of them. I don't know where they came from. And he clicks and they're available again.
Yeah, that's totally how it works at GW with the board games. The limited board games, there you go.
Certainly when it comes to Space Hulk.
Oh yeah. I really hope, though, that the Horus Heresy won't be a board game. I really want 30K to be more of a thing that more people have access to. Because I love the setting. Even though it's not Warhammer, which is what we're talking about primarily right now on this show. So.
You know what people are really excited for, though? Next week is the return of the Remster.
Ew.
Rem is going to be back from his tour of the US of A by next week.
Yes, you will have his magnificent hair back on the screen.
Yeah, I mean, my hair is quite magnificent, but we didn't see as much of it as usual this week since I was over there manning the gaming table.
That's true. But people had my hair. My nice groomed hair. Even reshaved my sides just for the camera. No, I didn't.
That's very, very stylish.
Isn't it?
Well, there's been about a billion comments on this episode, hasn't there? Now that I'm finally coming back to see it.
There was a lot going on. And, I mean, I'm a person who can't multitask at all. but I try when I really want to. So, but it kind of worked out. As we have seen, it works, as long as people aren't going too trolly in the comments.
And yeah, so to sum up for the ending of that battle, essentially, the dwarves now have Sigmar's blessing upon them. They've knelt down, and Sigmar has bestowed them with his shining light. He dangled the celestial carrot in front of them. And I'm not sure where this is going.
Yeah. Do you have a name for that scenario, by the way? Like the Golden Butt Pass? The Battle for Golden Butt Pass or something?
The Battle for Golden Butt Pass? I'm not sure.
Because it was kind of a pass with the two mountain sides.
Maybe the Battle for Golden Butt Passage. That might be better. More appropriate. If you can fend off the undead for a certain amount of time, then the Stormcast will come down, and then they'll imbue the statue with Sigmar's light, and he'll join the fight. And that rhymes.
That rhymes. That's true.
And Dead Gamer is wondering why he's not showing my face all show. It's because I only have the one webcam, and it's currently mounted on a tripod aimed at the gaming table.
You could lie down on the gaming table.
I'm sure people did see glimpses of my face when I was leaning across the table to handle the miniatures.
Maybe.
So they could see that I was wearing my orange outfit, as usual. Sofiskaku says, Sigmar got his massive golden carrot out, and the Duardin took it. Well, yeah. The Duardin, they accepted his blessing. Let's leave it at that. When Sigmar offers you his blessing and he shines that golden light upon you, you'd be a fool to turn it down.
I liked the scenario, though. I think it was quite quite narrative, quite fluffy. I especially liked the little unit of miners just sitting in their little hut and suddenly being overrun by zombies just peeking out of the windows. There's undead everywhere, while there's just those defenders of the past just coming to the rescue.
Yeah, I think with a little bit of tweaking, maybe, to make it a bit more, not exactly competitive, but obviously it was put together as just a fun little thing. But if you want to actually play it with someone and actually be competing for the win, then there can be a few tweaks made. For example, you roll at the start of each turn to decide whether the Stormcast come in, that kind of thing. And obviously the undead forces would be a bit more balanced. It wouldn't just be a billion zombies and skeletons and nothing else.
Yeah, a bit more characters, maybe a monster that comes in later to, like, balance out the giant or something.
Yeah, more monsters, more necromancers, vampires, and so on.
Yes, also the game totally should have piggies in it, because every game is better with piggies, as we all know.
There is a case to be made that piggies do improve games.
The giants could be throwing piggies at undead, and they would be too busy eating the piggies and couldn't run as fast the next turn.
I don't know, maybe the undead have read that article about bacon giving you cancer.
Oh, God.
So maybe they wouldn't do it.
I don't think undead would care about that.
I think undead are all over the internet.
Yeah, that's actually true. Actually true. There's a lot of them on Facebook.
Oh, actually, yeah. Now that you mention it. I think I've got a few in my friend request inbox at the moment.
Yeah. But funny enough, they actually want you for your brains.
So. Well, this has been a long show, hasn't it?
It has been a really long show. It's 1 a.m. here right now in Germany, about. And when did we start?
Well, it was around about 2.5 hours ago we started.
Wow, that's quite a long show. Once again, like, the Onion Ram show rarely seems to run under 2 hours.
And some people stuck all the way through as well. One thing I'm thinking about doing in a similar fashion to this is allocating particular audience members a unit, or maybe just one model. And there's like 5 dwarves against 5 undead or something like that. And then they all have to battle it out, and then one person reigns supreme. Something along those lines.
That would be a good idea. Also, maybe they could use a different channel, so to say, than the YouTube chats, if they have their allocated units already. I'm not sure what right now. It's just a thought.
Yeah,
maybe
just
Skype or something. I don't know.
Throwing ideas around. There's different ways of doing it. It's just something nice, I think, to mix up the show, because obviously there's not Age of Sigmar content to discuss every single week, because there aren't non-stop releases.
Yes. At least not enough to fill a two-hour show. I think that this was quite a nice experience in general.
And hopefully people who watched the show and weren't intimately familiar with the ins and outs and the inner workings of Age of Sigmar will have learnt quite a bit from watching it as well.
Yes.
Because I think we covered most of the important parts of the game, the ones that we didn't get wrong. But the important things like the turn sequence, deciding which combat to activate first, things like that, most things came up. Obviously we didn't have any spellcasters or anything like that.
It's true.
To keep it simple, I think there's probably too much stuff on the table, but it was all in just big units, so it didn't take too long.
Yeah, it worked out quite well. Also, there wasn't the thing happening that a lot of people criticized in the beginning about Age of Sigmar, where it would just be clumps, a big clump of model in the middle, and nothing else happening in the game. There were actually tactics being applied and working, as we have seen.
Hooves of Doom says he learned nothing. Well, we did learn, though, that hooves and teeth are more potent than the actual riders on horseback.
Yeah. The Stormcast armor is very vulnerable to horse teeth.
Also, we learned that Iron Drakes kick butt, if we didn't know that already.
And that skeleton hordes aren't as scary as they seem.
Yeah, huge amounts of zombies can be good, but they really need some synergy going on there. If they had a corpse cart or something with them, a necromancer giving them some extra bonuses, something like that. There are various war scrolls that can help each other out in the undead forces.
Indeed.
And the Stormcast, they're kind of like the World War II Americans. They just come in after most of the fighting's already taken place and they just take all the glory.
Yes, they do.
That's how they roll.
And get all the novels written about them, pretty much.
Yeah, they do actually, don't they?
They do. That's funny.
Stormcast Eternals, the glory hogs of the Age of Sigmar.
Certainly.
While the dwarves are down there doing the hard fighting.
In the trenches, in the dirt.
Yeah. It reminds me of, it's kind of like 40k novels where you'll have millions of Imperial Guardsmen dying and then one Space Marine comes in and kills an entire army on his own. And then everyone's like praising him and carrying him around on their shoulders. Like, all praise you, Space Marine.
I really hope there will be that aspect in Age of Sigmar 2 at some point. Like a human army again that is just dwellers of some realms that made swords and just went out to defend their lands. Something like that.
So, I think we should probably start wrapping it up now, since it's been a very, very long show. It might be the longest one yet, because of that wonderful game we were playing the whole time.
Certainly might.
So everyone can look forward next week to the return of the Rem, who's been missing for 2 weeks, and I think the world are just about ready to have him back.
Yes, he has been missed. I always like watching Rem. He's a good guy.
Yes, so he's probably going to have various tales of his American exploits to go through, and hopefully we'll have more info on the new Lizardmen, or the Seraphon, as we should call them from now on, to discuss as well.
Yes.
And maybe more shocking news developments. Maybe something will come out in the meantime. Some leaks.
Maybe we'll
learn that the dwarves are coming next.
Yeah, or the orcs, maybe.
Let's not go crazy now. And if anyone would like to leave any suggestions for similar episodes to this, where we just have a game of some kind going on, then leave them after the show in the permanent comments so we can actually go back and assess them all later on so they won't disappear forever.
Indeed.
Also, anyone who doesn't like the video, I will find out where you live and I will send Dready round.
Yes, and then I will dislike all your stuff in real life.
Yeah, she just come around and just thumbs down all your belongings.
Yeah, everything will get thumbed down. including your 2 inches of measuring device.
Two inch range spear.
Yeah.
So on that note.
On that note, indeed.
I think we should wrap it up. So, because there were some audio issues at the beginning of the episode, I think I'm going to redo my whistling antics from the beginning, because some people didn't hear it.
Yes, they missed out. So, here we go.
If you would like to say goodbye to the audience before I whistle us out.
I would. I had a good time playing this game tonight with you people, and we will see us when we see us, I guess. Bye! Enjoy the whistling. I might, maybe. Or maybe I'm turning my headset down right now, so I don't.